good morning, everybody, and welcome back to the second session of today. Our theme of this session will be about neonatal outcome. I will be moderating the session, and my counterpart will be Dr. Mahazen Azouz at the female side. We will start our session by Dr. Stefan Johansson, who is the consultant neonatologist and associate professor at Sachs Children's Hospital. And he will talk to us about HIE management update. Please, doctor.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you so much to the organizing and the program committee for having me here. I would also like to send my respectful wishes to the audience in the other room. I hope you can hear me well and also contribute with your questions afterwards. So I'm going to speak about birth asphyxia and HIE management. And if you have any questions afterwards, you can also email me or connect with me on LinkedIn. And you will all be having the PDF of the handouts by email from the secretariat. I would also like to advertise again our two meetings in Stockholm in June and in Hyderabad in India that you also can have a look at afterwards. So, I will say a few words about birth asphyxia for the coming half hour. The word asphyxia comes from Greek and it means pulseless in Greek. But we as clinicians, we think about hypoxia and what happens then with increased anaerobic metabolism, acidosis, and depletion of energy reserves. And for families, severe birth asphyxia can be a disaster because it's not uncommon that it has been a normal pregnancy of a healthy fetus that ends unexpectedly bad. And many of the survivors of severe birth asphyxia have significant problems afterwards. Speaking about parents, you will have this link in the handouts. This was a British father who had a severely asphyxiated baby. And he was a cartoonist on one of the major newspapers in the UK. And he made a fantastic video, which I highly can recommend. You have the link in the PDF afterwards. So, we often think about cerebral palsy when we have a baby with birth asphyxia. And the rate of cerebral palsy is reported to be quite different in different reports. But I would say that the good papers report about 10 to 15% of cerebral palsy after birth asphyxia. But it is a public health question. This is data from the WHO. They estimate that almost 1 million deaths globally is due to birth asphyxia, and it accounts for 9% of the total under 5 mortality in the world. And naturally, it is the less advantaged countries who face the highest rates of infant mortality due to birth asphyxia. So, Virginia Apgar, I think she made one of the most remarkable inventions in neonatal medicine when she added the Apgar scores to infant assessment. And this was now, well, like 70 years ago. But it is still relevant. This is a paper from New England Journal of Medicine in 2001 where they looked at the Apgar score in relation to infant outcomes. And they found that if the Apgar score is 3 or lower at 5 minutes, the mortality rate was 25%, whereas if the Apgar score was reasonably good, 7 or up, the mortality rate was less than 1 per 1,000. They also found that the Apgar score was a much better predictor than acidosis, which is, I think, an interesting finding itself. So, in the neonatal unit, we don't think so much about the birth asphyxia itself, but rather the hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, which refers to the clinical situation of brain malfunction due to birth asphyxia. And our mission in the NICU is to manage that, the consequences of birth asphyxia. Last week, there was an updated review published in Archives of Disease in Childhood. You will also have this link in the PDF. It's a very interesting read, and I will show you some data from it later. You are, of course, well aware of the SARNAT staging of HIE, and I think this is important to teach to fellows and also all the nursing staff, because this is something we should be actively looking for, particularly since we commonly identify babies who would benefit from hypothermia by staging their symptoms after birth. So what is hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy? Well, this is a very simplified drawing. You have hypoxia, you have reduced cerebral blood flow that leads to a range of primary events and a range of secondary events. So with hypoxia, you lose your cerebral blood flow autoregulation, which ends up in a reduction of cerebral blood flow and anaerobic metabolism. And after the insult, you have blood reperfusion, energy failure, and you have a cascade of cellular electrolyte disturbances that leads to excitation, free radical formation, and disordered osmoregulation. And then, during the secondary phase of after asphyxia, you have inflammation, programmed cell death, apoptosis, and also suppression of synthesis of proteins for signaling, for example. So there's a lot of things going on after hypoxia. When does the brain injury occur? This is a common question, I think, from parents. They wonder, what is the brain like right now? And actually, the brain injury can be divided into two separate phases or stages. There is a direct necrotic cell death occurring very shortly after delivery, and then that is followed by the program apoptotic cell death occurring much, much later. And this implies or means that we need to start or target our treatments as soon as possible. So can HIE and birth asphyxia be prevented? Well, this is a question for our obstetricians and midwives. And in fact, it is very difficult to prevent birth asphyxia. CTG is shown to be a poor predictor of neonatal outcomes, and the more fancy way of doing CTG, fetal ECG ST analysis, does not seem to reduce risk of HIE compared to CTG either. There are large studies going on scalp lactate, and I believe we will have more data, and it seems from smaller trials that scalp lactate is a better tool for prediction. But what we as neonatologists and neonatal staff can do, that matters. And I think that is nicely demonstrated from low-resource settings. I think you're all aware of the WHO initiative Helping Babies Breathe, which was shown to reduce infant mortality by 50% in a smaller pilot trial in Tanzania. And we can also organize our care well, meaning that we have a similar management of those babies 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. The graph here, see if I can use the pointer. The graph here shows the asphyxia-related infant neonatal mortality in Sweden over the 24-hour day. And it seems that it is peaking early when the morning staff came, and meaning that they are probably handling things that were not handled well during the night. And it is also peaking late during the day, which could imply that the shifting period here is not an optimal period of time for deliveries. So what can we do? Well, we can do a lot of things. We can resuscitate well, monitor well, induce hypothermia, and we hopefully in the future can also use neuroprotective agents. I come back to that also. Resuscitation is not a topic that you are, you all know everything about this, I'm sure. I just added the link there to the updated international guidelines. With regard to the general management in the NICU, it is always important, but in this context, it is essential to try to normalize the vital parameters as much as possible, because it's known that both hypo and hyperoxia is bad for the brain, the asphyxiated brain. You need to maintain a normal carbon dioxide and a normal perfusion. So there are lots of things to monitor and manage during NICU care. I guess that many of you also have access to amplitude integrated EEG, which has a good, relatively good predictive value when it comes to the long-term outcomes. If you have a tracing that normalizes during the first few days, that is a very good prediction of a good outcome, whereas if you still have a burst suppression tracing after the first day especially, that is a less good chance of a good outcome. So, shall we be using AEEG as a criteria for hypothermia? In the trials of hypothermia, only about half of the trials used AEEG tracings as an inclusion criteria. And in the Swedish guidelines, they do not require an abnormal tracing before initiation of hypothermia. But we, in my unit and in most units, I know that we use AEEG, and I think it helps our decision making in terms of hypothermia. So what about hypothermia? How good is it? Well, I would say it's very good, but it's not the golden bullet for this condition. We know that hypothermia alters the processes both during the primary and the secondary phase of HIE. And there's a lot of animal data showing that the therapeutic window for hypothermia closes around 6 hours after the insult. So how do we achieve or treat babies with hypothermia? Well, it's very simple, and I'm sure you're all practicing a similar protocol. We have first an induction phase, which takes typically half an hour, and then we cool for 72 hours at 33.6, and then we rewarm during like 8 hours. Our guidelines in Sweden is that we try to identify those infants who may benefit from hypothermia by admitting babies with A criteria. And those are that if a baby has 5 or lower in APGAR score at 10 minutes, or if they are resuscitating continuously over 10 minutes, or if they have more severe acidosis, we admit babies and monitor them. And we monitor for HIE or seizures. And we cool babies who have seizures within 6 hours or develop HIE grade 2 or 3 within 6 hours. So what can we achieve with hypothermia? Well, this is the summary from Cochrane. And it summarizes both the selective head cooling trials and the whole body cooling trials. And it's a very consistent pattern. Almost all trials show an effect in themselves, and taken together, they show a clear reduction in mortality and major disability with a narrow confidence interval as well. So what we know is that the risk of death is decreased by approximately 25%. And since the baseline risk of death is so high, the numbers needed to treat comes down to around 8, meaning that you need to cool around 8 babies to have one additional disease-free survivor. But although the risks are decreasing dramatically, I would say, there are still a significant proportion of cooled babies that develop adverse outcomes. like cognition problems, cerebral palsy, etc. 30 to 50% in the various trials. So, and one of the complicating situations are that cooling is commonly offered in the tertiary centers, but babies are born everywhere. So how do you manage outborn patients with encephalopathy? Well, cooling can be initiated anywhere because it's a simple technology. But of course, there are different approaches or ways to achieve cooling. You can cool babies passively by just reducing or shutting down the warmer, and you can cool actively with the servo-controlled mattresses that I guess you also are using. And this was a paper in pediatrics a few years ago that compared time periods in their unit where they didn't have servo-controlled mattresses for transportations and during the other period when they had that. And active cooling during transportations resulted in earlier cooling. They reached the target temperature much, much faster, and the cooling was much better, so they could maintain the cooling temperature during transportation. So what about the future of hypothermia? Well, one issue of debate has been the temperature itself. How low should you go with cooling, and how long should you be cooled? Relatively recently, there was the results from deeper and longer cooling was reported, and it seems that cooling for 120 hours instead of 72 and 32 degrees instead of 33.5 did not improve outcomes. So the hope for the future is rather to use the strategy we use today and add on neuroprotective agents. So what about neuroprotection? Is it a hype or is it a hope? Well, there are a great number of possible targets for neuroprotection, especially during the secondary phase when we have the inflammatory response and the apoptosis. And in short, it is likely that preventing or reducing seizures is good to inhibit the free radical formation and to scavenge those free radicals that are existing, and also reducing the excitation of neurons and, of course, reduce apoptosis and inflammation. This is a table from this recent review by Robertson and her group. And as you can see, there are a lot of different agents that are very interesting, I would say. Melatonin, for example, erythropoietin, xenon has been on the agenda for a long time now. Allopurinol is another interesting agent that reduces free radical production. We can read this in detail later. So, I think that we shall be expecting neuroprotection in the future. But as for now, there are no agents or treatments that are ready for implementation in regular clinical care. But I hope they will be in the future. So, another very important thing to remember is the high risks of adverse outcomes, meaning that a post-discharge follow-up is essential for those families and babies, because a significant number of those babies will develop problems in the future. In Sweden, we have different follow-up programs at the moment. We're trying to harmonize them, and the aim is to follow these children until they start school at the age of 7. So, to summarize, I think that I would like to highlight that monitoring for HIE itself after birth asphyxia is quite important, because that way you're able to identify those who would benefit from hypothermia treatment. It is naturally essential to monitor and manage all vital parameters, especially the ventilatory care, I would say, and it is essential also to manage seizures and monitor for seizures. We all know that hypothermia reduces the risks related to HIE, although we do not completely take the risks away. It is recommended to use this, to have criteria-based guidelines so that you have a uniform strategy for identifying those that you, in the end, cool. We should aim to start as soon as possible. The animal data shows that earlier is better. With humans, it is shown that within 6 hours is a good time window. We should keep the babies for around 33.5 over 3 days. And after discharge, we should be following those babies and families. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Stefan, for this nice presentation.